Good evening, everyone. I'm Harold Holzer, and I have the privilege of serving as the Jonathan Fanton Director of the Roosevelt House. And on behalf of Hunter President Jennifer Rabb, it's a pleasure to welcome you. You can feel the buzz in the air over this event, and I'm glad you're here. Tonight's program was brought to us by our friends at the Eleanor Roosevelt Val Kill Partnership, and we're delighted particularly to welcome Manuela, who I'll introduce more formally, Manuela Roosevelt, who Executive Director Yuri Perrin, and all of their members. And I want also to acknowledge a very special guest, the great biographer of Eleanor Roosevelt, Blanche Wiesencook. Now to this evening's program, and those of you who've attended Roosevelt House programs in the past know that for several years we have hosted a popular lecture series about Winston Churchill, sponsored by my friend Tina Flaherty, who's also here tonight. Thank you, Tina. A series that certainly fit into our mission of remembering President Roosevelt as Commander-in-Chief together with his World War II allies. We shouldn't forget the two women who served in their way as first ladies of their respective beleaguered nations during the war, both working to inspire and reassure in their own ways, both boasting fascinating relationships with their respective husbands and their respective publics. I love one part of the book in particular, after Clementine Churchill led him on an exhausting tour of London's air raid shelters. This is right out of Sonia Purnell's book. FDR's Treasury Secretary, Henry Morgenthau, paid Clementine Churchill the highest compliment. He said, "The dame is unbelievable. She's like Mrs. Roosevelt." A high compliment. We want to hear about that connection and all that our guests have to tell us tonight, but let me remind you just some housekeeping first. That following the program, we will head upstairs to the Four Freedoms Room for a reception and a book signing. You can buy books and have them autographed as you join us for the reception. Please welcome now for her to introduce the conversation with Sonia Purnell. Here is Manuela Roosevelt.
Welcome, everybody. I'm so glad we're here at home, so to speak, and cozily sitting together. I was very, very, very happy when I heard that a biographer was up at a Hyde Park researching Clementine Churchill. I said, how interesting. So I went to look for her, and we ended up spending days together, and the conversation became more and more fascinating and deeper. Behind every great man, Winston and Clementine Churchill had an exceptional partnership, though the marriage was not without its bumps. They slept in separate rooms and argued epically over money and children. He confided in her, and she advised him with a keen understanding of what was needed for his political survival. She was his spin doctor, lobbyist, speech coach, and the one person on whom he depended utterly. When he chose to ignore her, it was generally at his peril. He wrote her hundreds of letters on every conceivable topic, some desperate and pleading, but when it came time to write his histories, he left her out. Initially a shy, nervous young woman from a broken home, Clementine was tested to the limits by her marriage to Winston. But it also pushed her to become a formidable figure in her own right. Yet her complete devotion to her husband and his career came at the expense of their children. Veteran political commentator and biographer Sonia Purnell has finally captured in vibrant detail one of the greatest political partnerships of all times. Rectifying an astonishing act of historical omission, this is the first fully researched biography on Clementine Churchill. Sonia accessed new archives and combed the US and the UK for diaries and letters. She interviewed Clementine's personal assistants, whom no one had sought out before, surviving family members and descendants of key American players. The book reveals just how instrumental she was in paving the way for America's entry into the war. Never has diplomacy been so personal or so sexual. American support was vital for Britain's survival, and the Churchills would stop at virtually nothing to win it. The book also sheds new light on her relationship with Eleanor Roosevelt. Clementine admired Eleanor, but she chose a more personal and less public approach to influencing her husband, and in the end, she had far more influence. The two women pioneered two opposing archetypes of the modern First Lady. Welcome, Sonia.
Thank you. Thank you all so much for coming. It's so wonderful to be here, and a great thrill to be in Roosevelt House and to see you all coming along and finding out more about Clementine and Eleanor. And I thank Manuela so much. She's been such a support throughout this book. It's been really exceptional. Many others here in this room have also been very helpful and supportive, and I really thank you all. It's been a great thrill to come to the States. This is my second sort of major trip to the States, and I'm now completely in love with it. So I'm very, very happy to be here. Funny enough, when Clementine Churchill was a young woman, she wasn't particularly enamoured of the United States. In the 1920s, she was wary of the way the United States was kind of becoming the world's number one superpower. That used to be Britain's job, after all. She took a great interest in politics, always in international relations. She was unhappy at the refusal to forgive Britain's war debts. She knew all about this. She always did. From the time that she married Winston, she immersed herself in politics, both domestic and international. And it was only really when she came here in 1930, in pursuit of her son, who was declaring plans to marry at the age of 19 or so, a certain Kay Halley, did I pronounce it correctly, from Cleveland, Ohio, which I think someone that some of you will have heard of. And she apparently had set her sights on young Randolph, and Clementine wasn't going to have any of this. He was far too young. So she embarked over to the States to rescue her son. I'm not sure there was much rescuing to do. Maybe it was just an excuse to come over to the States. She came on a very nice luxury liner and apparently had massages and dinner in bed and pedicures and things. It was all quite good fun. And when she came here, she had this wonderful taste of American life. Randolph showed her around. He took her to speakeasies. I don't know how many sons took their mothers to speakeasies, but he did. She also went to rather more sedate luncheons with senators, so she saw the full kind of spectrum. She visited the White House, or rather she gazed at it from the outside. She went down south and went swimming in warm waters, not something we Brits get to do very often at home. And when she was in New York, she loved the shopping, she loved the art, and she started calling Fifth Avenue Fifth Ave, just like a local. This was all really, really splendid. And she reported back to Winston that she sounded quite surprised about it initially, that many Americans were extremely nice. And she was also rather fascinated by this newfangled American idea of female networking. This was not something that had yet been invented in Britain, and she was clearly struck by the way that a lot of American women were more emancipated than their British cousins. And she'd always been a suffragist. She'd been very much in favour of the female vote for a very long time, and she'd had really some of those epic rows with Winston were on that subject, because this was not something that he was keen to see, the idea of the female vote. But she would have, I think, quite liked the film that's out right now called Suffragette, because she went to a lot of the major suffragette trials herself, although she did actually once save Winston's life from a suffragette, because they were at a station and a suffragette came along. He was always a target and pushed him in front of a train that was just leaving the station, and it was only down to Clementine's quick thinking. She leapt over a pile of luggage and yanked at his coattails and pulled him back. And, well, you know, we might not be here now if she hadn't done that. So she saw both sides, but she certainly agreed with the principle, no doubt about that. On a subsequent visit to New York, a slightly less happy thing happened than on her first one. This is when Churchill, I'm sure some of you know, was knocked down by a taxi on Fifth Avenue, and actually has some pretty nasty head and thigh injuries and was carted off to hospital. And news got through to her. She was at Waldorf Astoria Towers. And she was so upset and so desperate to see him, she left the hotel without putting her shoes on. So that just shows what kind of distress she was in. What happened after that accident made her even more fond of America. People were very kind to both of them and went out of their way to look after them while he recuperated. And so that link with America became really quite a strong personal, emotional one. And in 1940, when Churchill became Prime Minister, think what it was like then. Think about how France was falling. The Benelux countries had already fallen. The Brits thought that Britain was definitely going to be next. Nazi Germany was massing its troops, its planes, everything else to make it strike. And we didn't have the men or the armaments really to defend ourselves for very long. And as one minister of the time said, that the peril that we were in was sort of unimaginable, really. Anyway, on one of those tumultuous days, Winston was shaving in his bathroom and his son Randolph entered. There's a lot of going in and out of bathrooms in Churchill's houses, by the way. They were never prudish about people seeing them in the bath or shaving or doing much else. And Clementine was also like that. She used to summon her secretaries to give them their day's task while she was in the bath. But anyway, there was Winston shaving, and Randolph came in and said, "Well, are we going to survive?" And Churchill said, "Yes, I see the way through this now." And as he swung round, he threw his razor into the basin, sort of for effect, I guess, and said, "I'm going to drag America in." And sure enough, from then on, the Churchills, I suppose they sort of launched a joint campaign to do anything they could. Of course, America didn't come into the war as a combatant until Pearl Harbor happened some 18 months later. But in that intervening 18 months, there was much done that to persuade America to provide Britain with absolutely essential ships, guns, cash, anything, just to keep us going. And how they did that, how they entertained, or how they persuaded America, very sceptical America, understandably unwilling to get involved in yet another European squabble on the other side of the pond. A lot of isolationists wanted nothing to do with this. So they had their work cut out for them, but they had this way of entertaining. Hospitality was a secret weapon for the Churchills. Together, they just sort of cast a magic spell over people. Her food, her interiors, his charm, their joint persuasiveness has a quite remarkable effect on at least three very key men who had FDR's ear, Harry Hopkins, Avril Harriman, and Gil Wynant. Being but three, the journalist Ed Murrow was another. Of course, it wasn't just hospitality they unleashed on these gentlemen, as you probably know. There was a certain Pamela who was also unleashed on Americans and worked her way through several of them and was able to cement Anglo-American relations, shall we say, and did her patriotic duty in persuading them that Britain was a marvellous place with marvellous people that really should be saved and could be saved. And Eleanor Roosevelt was another American visitor, obviously an absolutely, massively important one. And she came to Britain in October 1942 to see for herself what war was like. We were talking about her just now and how incredibly courageous she was in war. I mean, flying then was not like it was now. You couldn't go up to high altitudes. The cabins were unpressurized. You could be obviously shot down any moment by enemy gunfire. So she came over to Britain at a time when it was really extraordinarily courageous of her, and she wanted to see what it was like and to visit US troops. And the more I looked into that trip, and I read her diaries, and I read accounts of other people, and I read newspaper reports, and I saw what Clementine wrote about it, the more I realized that trip was unbelievably important, but again, has been overlooked until now, or little understood. And what happened during that time was that Clementine watched Eleanor with amazement. It was a bit like going back to that female networking again. She had never seen a woman in her own right do what Eleanor did. Eleanor got standing ovations in about 8 different British cities. People waited outside the American embassy just to see her. They loved her. There was something about her that connected with the people. So she talked to people, all sorts of people, all sorts of different walks of life. She was informal, she was chatty, she was concerned, and she was out there, and she was doing it by herself. Well, I think it's fair to say that Clementine really was quite taken by all of this. And she watched and she learned. And she also, I think part of this was diplomatic, had a diplomatic motive. She was always thinking, how could she benefit Britain's cause? That she wrote to FDR, probably her first letter to him. But the sentiments she expressed in this letter were absolutely genuine. And what she said was, and this was talking about the effect that Eleanor had on the people that she talked to all over Britain, was that she really sort of boosted their morale. And what she said was, when she appears, wrote Eleanor, the faces of the people she was visiting light up with gladness and welcome. And then she added, I was struck by the ease, the friendliness and dignity with which she talked with the reporters as well. So she was also such a skillful media maestro. And by the esteem and affection with which they evidently regard her. Well, Clementine had spent her entire life avoiding reporters. And so this was a totally new approach to things. And I think she realized from this that how much more she could do if she pushed herself out of the shadow. Sure, she was incredibly important as a support and advisor, and as Manuela was saying, a lobbyist, and she vetted the speeches, and she helped rehearse them, and she did all those things, but she hadn't really, until that point, pushed herself forward as much. The following year, 1943, she went to the Quebec conference with Roosevelt. Eleanor wasn't there. She'd gone to the Pacific on a mission to visit US troops. I think FDR was really quite shocked that a woman had turned up to something like this, and particularly Mrs. Churchill. You know, Churchill was clearly quite reactionary in his view, women in other ways, but then Clementine was no ordinary wife, and she did much to support and counsel Churchill at that conference. But she also invoked Eleanor Roosevelt's spirit, because just after the conference, they went down to DC, and she held her first ever solo press conference right there. And it was a triumph, one that had echoes of Eleanor, helped her make a favorite with the American people. She was hailed by the US press for being a brilliant platform speaker, as well as being witty, direct, and daring. They had even, although she was at this point in her mid-50s, so hope for us all, decided that she was one of the prettiest of English women that you could possibly find, and she was in possession of engaging dimples when she smiled. So there was the human side, but also the political side. She knew what she was doing. She knew she had to go out there and do a bit of wooing herself. And she handled those journalists with aplomb, by turn serious, by turn humorous. And all this was doing the British cause no end of good. And it was also doing the British cause no end of good when it was losing ground in the White House itself. This was when FDR and Churchill were not as close as they had once been. And so the Washington Times Herald, was just one paper, and I quote, to claim that Clementine was Churchill's greatest asset. And yet these journalists knew only half of it. They didn't know that this woman in front of them had been an unbelievably fearful child, very timid, very shy, very reserved, containing all her fears under this jokey, clever, outgoing exterior. So not only that, but also just how important she was back at home. How, when you read the letters to him, when you read the notes, when you read the accounts of the people around them, how much she was, she influenced him, how she was his greatest advisor, how his chief of staff once said that without her, the history of Winston Churchill and the history of the world would have been very different. You would never have known that when you saw her, and you would never have known that she came from a rackety background. Sure, she was aristocratic, but her home was broken one. Her mother was divorced. There wasn't always much money around. Occasionally, there wasn't even food on the table. The man she thought was her father wasn't actually her father. It was probably the First Lord Reedsdale, the grandfather of the Mitford sisters, who also happened to be her uncle by marriage. It was one of those things that used to go on in British country houses around that time. But all of this, she'd sort of learnt to kind of contain, looking at Eleanor Roosevelt's example. And I'm delighted to see how Eleanor's been talked about so much now. I'm going on this tour around America. People come up to me and say, well, I'm so interested in Eleanor, and now I really want to know about Clementine too, and very much down to sterling efforts of Manuela and so much of you. And we can draw great inspiration from this pioneering woman. But I do sometimes find it bizarre, actually not sometimes, most of the time, I find it bizarre that until now, really, Clementine, who, and I'll talk about their relationship in a minute, was her direct counterpart, her friend, the other sort of female half of the, you know, the people at the top of the Anglo-American alliance, how her role in all of this has been ignored. This must be the only time in history when we had two such great first ladies on either side of the Atlantic, two that were clever enough, ingenious enough, determined enough, focused enough, well-briefed enough to paper over the cracks of the Anglo-American alliance when they had to. And, you know, FDR and Churchill did fall out on many, many subjects. And it's interesting that to look at the cross-currents between those two couples. Because, as I say, FDR and Churchill did fall out sometimes, but there were also other cross-currents. Churchill was not terribly fond of Eleanor, I am afraid to say. I think he admired her hugely, but I think her kind of quite forceful, uncompromising attitude to certain subjects didn't always appeal to him. He was sort of used to kind of more retiring women, even though his own wife wasn't always that way. Also, when he visited the White House, he used to be shocked at the Roosevelt cooking, which Ernest Hemingway apparently described as some of the worst ever. And he was particularly upset by the fact that he hated creamy soup, absolutely hated it, and he was served it almost every day on every visit at the White House. And actually some, you know, say that, well, they put all sorts of, possible motives to that. I shall let you allow your own imaginations to think what they might be. By contrast, actually, Clementine was quite obsessed by food and making sure that it was as ambrosial as possible. This was part of their dinner table diplomacy. This was part of how they persuaded skeptical Americans that Britain was worth saving and could be saved. And she had this file that she kept on all guests so that she knew what their favorite food was. Harry Hopkins apparently likes Stilton. So Stilton was found by hook or by crook every time Harry Hopkins came round. And that wasn't easy, I can tell you, during war. Eisenhower apparently liked stew, so that's what he was given. Eleanor was equally a bit iffy about Churchill. She thought he might well be a bit of a drunken warmonger and one who was in danger of leading her husband astray by keeping him up late and drinking, which is not what was actually terribly good for him. But she also thought that he had rather reactionary views on women and the Civil War and a few other subjects. We'll come on to that in a second. Okay, so I'm just going around the dinner table now. If you can imagine the four of them around the table, so we're shifting around a bit. So Clementine could be a little bit rigid at times, I admit that. And when she first met FDR, well, there was a little bit of a crisis because he presumed to call her Clemmy. And you weren't allowed to do that unless you'd known her for about, well, at least 2 years and had earned the right in some way. And this was the first time that they'd met. I think she probably just about disguised the fact that she was furious. But note in the book that I don't allow myself to call her Clemmy until the very last page. And I think maybe, hopefully, I had earned the right by then. So she also fretted that Churchill was a little bit too enamored of FDR. I mean, Churchill wrote these things about how he was in love with the president and how his friendship honored him greatly. And Clementine worried that, of course, they had to be as close as possible, but that sometimes FDR was the better politician, maybe, more strategic, more calculating, less emotionally transparent. And she was worried that Churchill sometimes gave himself away. She also thought, though, that Churchill was sometimes in danger of alienating the Americans completely with some of his views. And one of her most forthright letters to Churchill, which they sent to each other down corridors, by the way, it's all very strange, but they were under the same roof. They couldn't text each other, so they did this, was that when he was supporting the exiled Greek king, who was very sort of unpopular, he wanted to put him back into Greece, and he thought this was a way of stopping civil war, but everyone just thought he was being sort of that old monarchist imperialist again. And so Clementine wrote him a letter saying something like, on no account speak to anyone else about what we discussed this morning before I can talk to you again and explain what needs to be done here. I mean, that's the kind of way that she could sometimes talk to him, and it is quite surprising for those who don't understand that. And then finally, FDR and Churchill. Well, FDR was clearly starstruck by him initially, but I think maybe some of those late-night drinking sessions, some of those fallings out over how the war should be conducted or what should happen afterwards, meant that the, you know, this was not a match made in heaven, and towards the end of the war, they were more distant than they had been at the beginning. But these two women here that you see on the screen grew to trust and admire each other more and more. They were from different worlds in some ways, Eleanor much more public, but the similarities are quite remarkable. They were of a similar age, aristocratic background, great love of the poor, dislike of gambling for very similar reasons. Because of that, they'd both been described as crashing bores at various times. Both had been schooled in England and taken in hand by an inspirational headmistress. They'd both had difficult, challenging, unhappy childhoods at times, and they'd both been considered plain when young, you know, which is not easy for a girl. They were both married now to these men who had the task of saving the world, but who were not, let's face it, exactly easy. Both of them felt that they weren't very good mothers, that they I think, both had doubts about that, and actually both did rear quite difficult broods in many ways. Although both enjoyed being grandmothers more, and both were very good at Christmas, interestingly. They both put great store in Christmas, as if to make up for the rest of the year when they weren't such good mothers. They both also suffered from depression at various times, but both were brave and stoical. Eleanor, we know, because we see it in the diaries, thought Clementine was attractive, youthful and charming, but also constrained by her husband's notion that women should remain in the background. Now, lost my clicker. Here we go. But they met again. Let me just find this thing. Oh, hang on. No, I need to go back, because they met again at the second Quebec conference. I want to try and find a picture of them, whether they're together. Oh, where has it gone? Where has it gone? Oops, no. Okay, well, she'll come back to that in a second. Oh, by the way, do you all know who that is, the third from the left, that lady there? Pamela, that's right. Okay, so she was also their secret weapon, and all part of the chapter entitled Operation Seduction USA, and she was the chief proponent of that. I will try and find this conference picture of the two ladies together, because once again, they met at the 1944... Where on earth has it gone? All these have gone out of order. Oh, okay, well, let's have that picture. That's what, later, after the war. I love this picture. Don't they look like two old friends catching up on a good gossip? And, in fact, they did stay in touch right until Eleanor's death. But anyway, back to the wartime. So Eleanor wrote about her. She has had to assume a role because of being in public life. The role is now part of her, but one wonders what she is like underneath. And I think she found out a little bit after a trip to Canterbury, again on that trip in 1942, They went to Canterbury, in a county of Kent, southeast England, actually not that far from Dover, so not that far from France. And that day was rather wonderful. Great crowds of women and girls surged forward, smiling. They wanted to see both these women. It was a really happy day. They both found it extraordinarily moving and touching. And then the next day, as if it had been too successful, the Germans bombed Canterbury pretty much all day in daylight, and it's quite likely that quite a few of those women and girls who'd been so welcoming and so happy were killed. And shaken by this, Eleanor wrote to FDR that the spirit of the English people was something to bow down to. It was a moment of sort of female solidarity. It was something that affected them both, and I think it was something that led them to understand a little bit more. And indeed, I think Clementine did lower her guard a little bit. And I want to just tell you one evening that happened during that trip, when Eleanor was invited to a intimate dinner party at Downing Street, always on a round table, by the way. The Churchills thought that a round table was much better at keeping the conversation going, and it also meant that no one was at the head or at the bottom of the table, so sort of more egalitarian, very good for that dinner table diplomacy. Anyway, there they were in Downing Street, bomb-blasted Downing Street. Clementine was brilliant at making the most unpromising interiors into something elegant but cosy. So she put chintz curtains up, she put a few paintings up, she put nice antiques, and it kind of drew the eye away from the fact that there were steel shutters at the window and pit props holding up the roof. Anyway, so there they were at dinner, and the subject turned to the Spanish Civil War. And Well, Eleanor said something along the lines of, you know, why hadn't the Allied powers or whatever, Britain, America, whoever it was, done more to help the Republicans? Well, Winston was furious and he rose from the table. He couldn't believe that a woman, a guest, was kind of, you know, challenging him in this way. And his fury was obvious. But at that point, Clementine leant forward and said, I think perhaps Mrs. Roosevelt is right. And so she, as well, had gone against Churchill. Well, Churchill signalled that dinner was over, and off he went. And it's very sort of interesting, quite a telling moment, because Clementine never, you know, contradicted her husband in public, but there she was doing that in front of the First Lady of America. Now, why was she doing that? Was it female solidarity? Well, there probably was an element of that, because I think her politics were more in line with Eleanor's than they were with Churchill's. Was it perhaps the fact that she knew that nothing must happen to damage that Anglo-American alliance because we were sunk without it? So was she actually thinking more clearly than Churchill? We don't know because we can't read inside Clementine's mind. But I think she was. There was probably a little bit of both of those ideas. But certainly they did become closer and closer during the war. And there's this one thing that another conversation actually between the two men that I think gives a clue as to how Clementine was very, very powerful at home. One evening in the White House, FDR and Churchill having a drink, Churchill said to FDR, I noticed that you don't tell Eleanor everything about the war. Eleanor didn't even know he was coming. Churchill was coming to the White House until a few minutes beforehand. And he said, I tell Clemmy everything. And obviously FDR had noticed this, and he said in reply that he couldn't tell Eleanor everything in case she put something in her newspaper column the next day. But so it was a different relationship, the Churchills and the Roosevelts. But I think Eleanor probably was watching Clementine and watching the kind of power that she had behind the scenes. And together, they realised that they could do a great deal. So the broadcast that you saw in the previous slide, that was Eleanor's idea. She was pushing Clementine more and more into the limelight. Clementine even hid behind a potted palm. She was so keen to avoid broadcasting. She was very shy. She was yanked out, and Eleanor said, no, we're coming, we're doing this together. And they went on to broadcast many times together, and they wrote to each other. And, I really do think it was an extraordinarily important relationship. And Eleanor inspired her with that chatty, informal style. And Clementine went out more and more, and she talked to more and more people. And that's why we ended up with the incident we heard about just now, about the dame is unbelievable. She's just like Mrs. Roosevelt. Well, she'd learnt from Mrs. Roosevelt. So, that wasn't totally surprising. So over time, Clementine's early critics, what was this woman doing, all this stuff, became fans. She helped in so many ways. By the end of the war, she was more popular than Churchill. In fact, when Henry Morgenthau wanted a trip of the air raid shelters, no one dared send him with Churchill in case he was booed. In fact, most of the ministers couldn't go. People were fed up. There were 6 years of war by this stage. There seemed to be no end to it, no hope. The only person who could be guaranteed, absolutely guaranteed, to get a good response was Clementine. So it was Clementine who took him around the air raid shelters, and it was Clementine he noticed in action that day. In 1945, as you know, Churchill was thrown out of power, and Clementine never really got involved in government again. When he became Prime Minister again in the 1950s, she didn't want to in the same way. It was a Conservative government. She was never really a Tory. She was always a Liberal. That's what suited her in the war, was that it was a coalition government. And again, you know, she didn't think that Churchill should have gone back. He was too tired and too old. And so she did sink into the obscurity where she is now. But when we talk about Eleanor, which we should talk about her more and more and think about what she did for all of us and what she pioneered. But very much part of that story is also Clementine and how those two women came together in those exceptional times. And when Eleanor went on to have her own career, her great, you know, independent career at the UN after the war, I imagine that perhaps Clementine looked on with some envy, because she really didn't have anything like that. She never had the chance to do that. But we shouldn't forget what she did during the war, just because she did retreat into that obscurity. Churchill himself said that he couldn't have done any of what he did in his life without her. But I would also say that her success as his greatest advisor, his, you know, chief strategist, his speech writer, all of those other things, which was very great indeed, was greater still because of her relationship and her friendship and what she learned and what she went through with Eleanor Roosevelt. So thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Sonia. It's a wonderful insight into the relationship between these four extraordinary characters. It must have been a fascinating aspect of your research to read all the letters that Winston and Clementine wrote to each other. Of course, we're not the beneficiaries of the same correspondence between Franklin and Eleanor. Mm. She burnt all the letters. But just to recall your last sentence, do you think it's fair to say, as some of your reviewers have suggested, that Winston might never have become Prime Minister without Clementine?
I think there's a possibility that he might not. I mean, after all, it's important to remember how many mistakes he made in his career and how often he nearly lost his career completely. I mean, look at the Dardanelles, for example, during the First World War, where it went disastrously wrong. Tens of thousands of young men lost their lives, rightly or wrongly. He was blamed for that. He lost his political career. He lost his reputation. They were scorned by pretty much everyone. You know, he might never have gone on to become the Prime Minister that he did in 1940. Clementine was there, very much encouraging him with this idea that he would volunteer to fight in the Western Front, to go out to the trenches. And then she kept urging him, actually urging is a slightly too weak word, she kind of told him, he didn't always obey, you know, mind you, to stay until he'd acquired what she called his military halo. As soon as he got out there, pretty much he wanted to come back and try and get back into politics. And she knew that was way too early, that he had to keep out there until they, as she called it, wanted him back, called him back. Well, he did stay out there longer, much longer than he originally intended. And that is really down to Clementine. And that was eventually what helped him come back into politics. Because we very nearly lost Winston Churchill completely at that point. And at other points in his career. I mean, believe me, this was kind of like a roller coaster ride right up until 1940. And of course, in the wilderness years in the 30s, they were scorned again. People would cross the street to avoid speaking to them. Many people in their own class couldn't understand why they were so anti-Hitler, because they saw him as putting a sort of muscular pride back into Germany, and that Germany was a bulwark against the Bolsheviks in Soviet Russia. So they fell out with so many people that they would once have known, and she stuck by him. Someone had to, and she stuck by him during that time. So yes, she never lost her faith. She always thought that he would be Prime Minister one day. She thought it might take a major event to make that happen. She probably didn't expect to have to wait until he was 65. But I think that her faith in him and her belief and her advice when he made mistakes and her advice, which helped him to avoid other mistakes, was absolutely crucial. And he did say that marrying her had been his most brilliant achievement.
In the book, you paint a very vivid picture of life within the Churchill household. What surprised you the most in your research about the way they lived?
I suppose until I really got to know them well, I didn't realize quite how tight money was and how sometimes the kids were told to, you know, turn off light switches quickly and stop making long telephone calls, and sometimes Chartwell was, you know, closed up. There was one winter in particular when it was closed up, mothballed, put under dust sheets because they couldn't afford to heat it or to run it, to employ the servants to run it. I mean, it had an absolutely enormous staff. It was a bit like Downton Abbey. In fact, you know, I don't know how many staff there are in Downton Abbey, but the Churchills at the peak had 20 full-time staff running Chartwell, and that doesn't come cheap. And the fact is that neither of them had their own family money. So almost all of that was paid for by his pen. Well, that's a lot of books. I know, being an author myself, that's an awful lot of books and a lot of articles to keep that lot going. And I suppose, you know, until I got to know them well, I had just never realised that they were always on this kind of financial brink. I mean, really, pretty much through their entire life. In fact, even after the war, it looked like they might have to sell Chartwell until a group of benefactors bought it and gave it to the National Trust, which owns it now, and they were allowed to live there for the rest of their lives. Although, interestingly, after Churchill died, Clementine decided she never wanted to live there again. She never liked Chartwell. That was always his thing, and he bought it behind her back, which she said was the only time that he betrayed her in her marriage, because he wasn't a kind of world leader type in the Clinton mold with lots of interns or whatever. He was, JFK with actresses or whatever it is, he was a totally faithful husband. So that was, I think, the only time that he betrayed her.
Winston was such a marvelous orator and delivered so many famous speeches, and we still find him eminently quotable today. How do you think she helped him in that sense with his speeches and his reaching out to the crowds?
Well, you might not believe it, but he was actually quite a nervous public speaker. He'd once, in his youth, once completely dried up mid-speech in the House of Commons. And it was just the most awful moment, and he'd had to sit down in shame and humiliation afterwards, and he never forgot that. So he was always quite nervous about speaking, and so she would try and rehearse everything with him to the absolute nth degree, to make sure that he was confident when he stood up. She also, with him at the beginning of the war, they came up with this idea that he would never use words. If you'd had quite a basic education, you'd have to look up in the dictionary. The view being that if it was simple, it would be more powerful. And if you think about those speeches, the words are quite simple and they are more powerful as a result. And she was very much part of that. And she edited the speeches. She certainly contributed a great deal of material to them. And there's also pretty compelling evidence that certain passages were written entirely by her. And there's a great letter up at the Roosevelt Library from Gil Winant, the American ambassador during the war, saying, Winston's speech today was one of his best, and yes, and I detected your passage about France in that part of it. So, you know, she was there, she was very much part of putting that together. Of course he was the great orator, and he was leading that, but she was really very much a hugely important assistant in that.
In the book you say that people were physically shocked when they first met Clementine, and she was not at all what they expected. What was she like?
Well, actually, let me just get the clicker, because I just wanted to show you a photograph that may illustrate that. She was taller than Churchill, and she was certainly much more athletic. She was an absolute fiend on the tennis court. You took her on at your peril. She won many amateur championships in the south of France and elsewhere. She also had a much louder laugh. I mean, look at this picture. She is really opening her mouth, and she is roaring with laughter. And apparently that was really infectious, and once you heard it, you just wanted to hear it again, and you wanted to laugh too. And when she was on form, and she did have her down days, I mean, she really, really did, and her depression after the war was grotesque in its seriousness. But when she was up, she was really up, and she was the life and soul of the party. I mean, look at Churchill. His is a kind of quiet chuckle. Now, you wouldn't think, perhaps, that she would be the one that would be sort of the loud one in that way, but she certainly was. And she was this force of nature. One of her daughters described her like a chandelier, sort of sparkle and light and glitter, and she was like that, and she was this wonderful hostess, obviously. And people expected her to be mousy and subservient, and she certainly wasn't. And just because you were a guest, if you came to her house and you voiced what she might think to be unpalatable views, she would make her displeasure known quite forcefully, and Churchill would refer to it as Clementine dropping out of a tree like a jaguar on her victim, and she would dispense with anyone. So she could be really quite a scary woman sometimes. But she could also be a very kind one. I don't want to give you the impression that she was cold. There was a great kindness there behind that formidable exterior, and she went out of her way to help those who weren't as lucky as wealthy or as fortunate as they were. So a complicated woman, but really an extraordinary one.
Thank you. I think we should open it up to questions from you all.
Clementine Churchill and I were named after the same Polish princess, Maria Clementina Sobieska, who married the pretender to the throne and then met by proxy, and she went to Bologna. And that's how I happened to be called Clementina, was the Italian side of it. But how did Clementine Churchill, because it was her daughter Mary, that I read it in The Finest Hours, said that that's who she was named after. And she mentioned that politically her family were Jacobeans. Am I right on there? Do you know much about that connection?
The family was always a liberal one, on the Distaff side anyway. I mean, certainly they were the sort of radical women who had very sort of radical views, although they also have very aristocratic tastes, and I think it was a sort of a way of combining the two. I think she did have Jacobean forebears, and she also had great sympathy for Ireland. I mean, that was something, actually, that was a really interesting area in which she completely changed Churchill's views. And she wrote him this formidable letter about what she described as his Hunnish approach to Ireland, I think in the form of the Black and Tans. I don't know how many you know about these paramilitaries, but they were sent into Ireland in the 20s to quell unrest and behaved, pretty unspeakably. And she took him on that. I mean, I think, you know, she had that sort of sympathy. She took him on. She said that, you know, put yourself in their position. Don't have these horrible Hunnish views. You should take a much more liberal approach to this. And he changed his position and actually became one of the leading negotiators in the treaty that ended up with the Irish Free State, which was the forerunner of what we have now, the Republic of Ireland. And they started inviting Michael Collins to their house for this famous dinner table diplomacy around the dinner table. I think a lot of people don't sort of give Churchill credit for that, and that he was actually involved in sort of the liberation of Republic of Ireland. So there were many, many influences at play here. And, you know, Clementine drew on all sorts of aspects of her own family experience to try and influence Churchill. That's certainly true.
What about the name?
Well, I think there may be two theories, or there may be two reasons why she was called Clementine here. The other reason may be that her mother was called Lady Blanche. Lady Blanche's sister was Clementine, also Clementine. And that Clementine was married to the first Lord Reedsdale, who was almost certainly Clementine's father. And many say that our Clementine, if you like, was partly called Clementine, as a tribute to her sister's forbearance in sharing her husband in this way. Apparently he was very handsome and very kind, and obviously very attentive, because he had plenty of kids with his own wife as well. So, as I said, those families were very complicated in those days, and the world's much more simple now in some respects. Yeah. Oh, yeah, big time. Again, one of the subjects that she was most forthright about, yes, yeah.
When you were discussing the food, you said that there was an agenda to the cream soup, and I've been sitting and thinking about the cream soup, and I don't know what the agenda is, and I would appreciate it if you would explain that. And also, could we please see the rest of the pictures?
Yes, of course. Okay, a quick note on the cream soup. Well, there are various theories. A, was it sort of a way of getting back at Churchill, who she obviously didn't, you know, care for that much? Or was it, as some people say, some sort of culinary revenge, sort of long-term culinary revenge against FDR for his affair earlier in the marriage? I mean, who knows? But it is sort of fun to speculate, although, again, it's difficult to know what was exactly inside Eleanor's mind on that. But
I'm not sure Eleanor cared for food so much. She had suffered from anorexia at some point. But I don't think the arts of the kitchen were really her thing. So she really didn't care, and I don't think she could understand why anybody would fuss about cream soup.
just one of their different outlooks in life. Many, many different. Okay, shall we just go through the, okay. Right, well, let's just go back to the beginning and I'll take you through. Bear with me, sorry. Okay. Right, we're nearly there, Okay, right. Well, that's Chartwell. So that's the house, the family home for 40 years, the only kind of long-term family home they have. That's what Churchill bought behind her back when she just had her final baby, Mary. And she never entirely forgave him, but she did what she could with what is actually a very difficult house. Lots of small windows, lots of little staircases and things. That wing to the right, they added that. The top room is her bedroom. Which has some nice views. His, by the way, was tiny, monastic, single bed. He liked it that way. You can't see the room. It's sealed off from the public because she felt that a global legend's bedroom shouldn't be open to the public. It didn't sort of quite chime with the idea that you're a legend. I mean, legends don't have bedrooms, do they? So, okay, there she is when she's young, that little tearful, fearful child. Found it difficult to make friends, always on the move. Carlo here, the dog, was her best friend until he died under the train that she was travelling on. He was trying to catch up, and she told her own children she remembered never having got over that. There she is, the suffragist uniform, the shirt and tie. This is before she got married. She didn't wear it so much after she married Winston Churchill, but she still attended suffragette trials and showed her solidarity in that way. There she is getting married with her brother, Bill, who, remember I talked about gambling and how Clementine and Eleanor both hated it. Well, Bill took his own life. He was a great gambler. He was always in financial difficulty, and he, a bit later on, took his own life, and it was probably connected. There she is, Mrs. Winston Churchill, thought to have the profile of a queen. People used to say she should have her face on a coin. But people also laughed at her because she'd been making her own clothes until she got married, and she had enjoyed a lot of kind of snobbish scorn when she first married him, which also gave her a drive, actually. I think this is quite important. She felt she must prove herself worthy of Winston Churchill, and I think that's what kept her going all those years. There she is. There's Churchill on the right. He was criticised hugely for his outfit, which was considered to be scruffy, and gave him the air of a glorified coachman. I think it's a little bit unfair. I think he looks fine, but that's what commentators of the day said about him. There they are. She often went to the office with him. She was often with him. They were a partnership. With the Churchills, you got two for the price of one. This was obviously at a peak in his career, because people taking their hats off there were plenty of times when they would be ignored. She did things women hadn't done before in Britain anyway. She went and observed military manoeuvres. She went and inspected naval shipyards, always looking rather elegant and glamorous while she did so. That nice fur muff. Fiendish tennis player, as I said. Winston was just nowhere. Yeah, great serve. Winston took very little exercise beyond picking up a cigar. So this was something she did without him. There we are, Chartwell drawing room. As I said, they never had huge amounts of money, so the antiques are not museum quality. They're good. She picked them up for a song. She's very good at that. The chandeliers are glass, not quartz. But she was very good at creating an atmosphere in a room without a massive budget, and good with colours. And it's a dark house, and so she painted everywhere in sort of pale colours that made the most of the light that there was, and she put mirrors in strategic places. So that's where you would be invited to have a drink before dinner or before lunch. She would have a sherry, and she would be standing there getting more and more anxious, because Winston would always still be in his bathtub, and the guests would all be there, and she'd send a particularly friendly one up to go and bang on the bathroom door and say, they're all downstairs waiting for you. He was always late. So she'd be standing here on many an evening, kind of doing this and getting quite worked up about it, because she thought lateness was rude. The dining room, quite interesting, just because she commissioned this furniture, which is very sort of contemporary. It's kind of bleached oak. You could go into a store and find that now with the rush matting too. It looks totally okay now. It just doesn't look old-fashioned, really. That's her bedroom, about four times the size of his, with that lovely kind of hanging on the bed, he had to ask permission to go there. And that was her domain. And if you're married to a hurricane, which is effectively what she was, sometimes you need to take shelter from the wind, and that's where she went. So this was her domain. Notice the white flowers from the garden. She would only have white flowers in her bedroom if she could possibly help it. And she liked very informal displays where you grab the flowers by the neck and then just jam them in the jar, and didn't like sort of fussy things. That's her headmistress on the left there, Beatrice Harris, who was a great inspiration to her, just like Eleanor had a great sort of headmistress too. They kept in touch really for the rest of Miss Harris's life. That was during the Dardanelles. I sort of love the painting, John Lavery, but it's spring 1916 when Winston was in the trenches, and you can feel that melancholy, I think. I mean, she does look sad. She's with Sarah there. Yeah. And that's Marigold, and that's the little girl that died. Both she and Eleanor lost her child in infancy. And I think also you can tell from that picture that she's slightly nervous with the child. She was never totally kind of at home with little children in particular. And poor old Marigold died at 2.5, and Clementine never really forgave herself. Another picture, a sweet picture of the family out and about. Remember I was telling you that she was a very fearful child, but she tried to contain those fears, and she became very good at hunting, which is, you know, a very scary thing. I certainly wouldn't do it. And this is another way in which she kind of reinvented herself as someone who was clearly formidable. There she is in Egypt in the 1920s. Lawrence of Arabia is the fourth from the left, unfortunately not in Arab clothes, but they became quite good friends. He came to Chartwell quite often. Ah, now this is the boyfriend. Now, in the 1930s, she went on this cruise, and this was at the peak of the sort of wilderness years in some ways, and she went on this cruise without Winston, and it was in the South Seas, and there was champagne, and there was sunshine, and there was no Hitler, and it was all rather magical, but there was this man who was rich and suave and athletic and tanned and not obsessed with Hitler and kind of not like Churchill in any way, and she was rather smitten. She's just short of her 50th birthday here, by the way. You wouldn't think so. Anyway, she put it later, oh, he made me like him. But I think he was almost certainly bisexual, and I don't think it really went anywhere. I think it was a diversion, and in a way it kind of concentrated her mind on the fact that she was married to this great man, and when she came back, she kind of really threw everything that she had into his work. There we are, Pamela Harriman, and there's Clemmy over on the right in the hat, obviously doing the wall. There's Randolph in the middle, looking at planes or something together. Aid to Russia Fund, I mean, she raised the equivalent of about $500 million now from a bankrupt country, kind of like a forerunner of Live Aid. She raised this money from charity football matches, concerts, gala days, all sorts of things. And the money went to Russia to re-equip hospitals that had been bombed by the Nazis. And she did a great deal to improve Anglo-Soviet relations as a result, which were pretty tricky. I mean, Stalin and Churchill were never going to like each other, obviously. But Stalin liked Mrs. Churchill so much, he invited her to meet him on her own in the Kremlin, in his study with Molotov in 1945, and gave her this award. I'm not going to spoil that story because it's rather a great one, but read about it in the book. There we are. There she is in Russia. There she is selling her own husband a thing for, AIDS Russia. There is, look at this extraordinary poster, Soviet style poster, but with the Churchill name on it. But she knew what she was doing. She was being clever politically here. So she was talking about the Soviet solidarity, which was also quelling discontent at home. People felt that the Brits weren't doing enough to help the Russians. So this is all part of her thing. This is one of my favorite pictures of her in wartime. And it kind of encapsulates everything. She's wearing that turban as a way of denoting solidarity with women factory workers who had to wear them because, you know, machinery, chemicals were dangerous. So she pretty much wore one every single day of the war, but she's also wearing Cartier diamonds. And, you know, kind of two sides of her world in one picture. Ah, there we are. There she is dancing with a worker at a factory. I think that's a very Eleanor Roosevelt kind of thing. I think at the beginning of the war, she would probably not have been able to do that. But now there she is, and this looks like fun. I think everyone's having a really great time there, great morale boost. So there she is laughing. There she is with Eleanor. There she is at Chartwell after the war. Look at the silver tea service. Everything was always done perfectly for Ella, for Clementine. There she was getting her damehood after the war, two daughters there. Some nice pearls. There they are on die right at the end of the war. I think she's picking up something there for Winston. There's two daughters again. Soames is the wonderful gossipy picture. And that's again, there we are, another picture I wanted to show you, which is again that kind of Eleanor Roosevelt style, informal, chatting to people, smiling. People found this incredibly lifting during the war. And she received thousands and thousands and thousands of letters thanking her for visiting and helping them and suggesting practical help. And I think, you know, this was very much part of her contribution.
I just want to say this is a spectacular and splendid book. Thank you so much. I have a bunch of questions, but two I really want to ask. Based on your incredibly profound research, one gets the sense that Clementine also was close to radicals in Parliament who Churchill, you know, including Eleanor Rathbone, who had this great committee to save the perishing, which I became obsessed about as I was going forward. And you have this extraordinary moment in the book where Clementine listens to Eleanor Rathbone's advice in terms of Russia and the Soviet Union. And that made me wonder, well, what advice might she have had about the committee to save the perishing, and evidently none at all.
Well,
and
I mean, I've searched high and low on this, and there seems to be surprisingly little. There was a little bit of correspondence, which I've put in the book, during that visit to Russia between Clementine and Churchill. Obviously, as some of the horror is beginning to emerge from the camps, as they're starting to be liberated, and he tells her about that. I mean, what we can learn from that, whether that means that he didn't know much about it before, I don't know. I mean, in a sense, that's another book. But it's quite suggestive because that subject doesn't appear in all of this correspondence, apart from pretty much that once, that they didn't know that much, because I'm sure otherwise it would be something that they would have discussed. After all, they had many Jewish friends. I mean, this was something that they were actually quite unusual in. A lot of the British ruling classes didn't particularly. They did. Sir Henry Strakosch, who helped them financially on more than one occasion, both before and during the war, he was Jewish, but there were plenty of others too.
And Bernard Baruch.
And, you know, Bernard Baruch, exactly. So to them, this was never something that, you know, that they... And also in the 30s, actually, don't forget, in the early 30s, when Churchill was already talking about the disgraceful, you know, treatment of the Jews by Nazi Germany. So their feelings were very clear. I just guess, and this is merely a calculated guess, that they simply didn't know what was about to come out, about what had been going on. But that is, as I say, another book. I mean, one that should definitely be written, but it isn't necessarily this one.
Thank you so much. Can I ask another? One more. I really would love your thoughts about, I mean, it must have been really difficult to live with Churchill, his drinking, his self-absorption, the ways in which they disagreed. How did she stand it?
Well, I think she loved it. I really genuinely think that this was a marriage of love. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't just sort of out of convenience or anything else. I think she also found him and the world that he inhabited exciting. And so, yes, of course, he was impossible sometimes. And that's why she would remove herself. And when it wasn't wartime, she'd go away. When it was wartime, she would retreat to another room. But I honestly believe that she believed in him, and she thought that it was her duty, her role in life, to make him the greatest politician that she could. And I think she found that thrilling. I mean, she once said that, oh, if only I'd been born with trousers, pants, rather than petticoats, I would like to have been a statesman. And that option wasn't open to her. What was open to her was managing Churchill. I mean, Clement Attlee, who was his Labour Prime Minister, and Prime Minister during the war, said that Churchill was 50% genius and 50% bloody fool. And I think Clementine saw it, and in fact, actually, Pamela Harriman put it this way, Clementine saw it as her job to stop Churchill running amok. And so it was almost like she couldn't just go off. It was absolutely beholden to her to bring the genius out and contain the other side of him. And that, to her, was thrilling and her life's work. And I think that's why she stuck around. Yeah.
Thank you, Sonia.